Hello YouTube. Today I'm at the tea table in Puer City and I'm going to talk about how the farmers make their decisions. As we've seen in the past videos, there are a lot of different operations that can be realized in the tea gardens. Now, what makes that some farmers will, for example, till the soil while others won't? Why some farmers fertilize the soil and others don't? Why some farmers spray herbicide to clear the weeds, while others will use trimmers or cut it with machetes? As tea consumers, we like to drink tea that comes from unfertilized, unsprayed tea gardens. The market values big tea trees which haven't been pruned for decades. We like to hear about ancient tea gardens which grow under very natural conditions. Now, why don't we find more of these gardens? Why do some farmers manage their tea gardens in a very intensive way, spraying chemical fertilizers, spraying pesticides, pruning their trees several times a year, and harvesting as much as they can? When you try to understand why the farmers do what they do in the tea gardens, you first have to consider how busy they are. You want to see how much workforce they have available and how large their tea gardens are. You also have to consider the other crops they might have. In many tea production areas, tea is only a part of the farmer's agricultural system. They have other crops. Maybe they grow rice, maybe they raise cattle, maybe they work for other people in their free time. On the other hand, heavily specialized tea farmers might rely on other people to cultivate their gardens, to harvest the tea and do all the other operations throughout the year. When the farmers design their production system, they try to stay busy throughout the year. If they have some free time, they will try to do operations which will increase their yield. Let's imagine you have a tea garden. If you do nothing in your garden and just want to get the leaves, you can do it. That will make you busy mainly during spring, a little bit in summer and autumn. You will have a lot of free time. And as a professional farmer, you want to do more than this. You want to increase your revenue, increase your production. So what can you do to increase the yield of your tea trees while you're not busy? Well, for example, after you've harvested the tea trees in spring, you can prune the tea trees so that the next flush will grow again earlier in the season. In a typical plantation, the tea trees are pruned at least once a year. They can also be pruned more than that if the farmers have time to do that. This will increase the output per tree and also increase the number of times you can harvest the tea throughout the year. Now you're in winter. In winter, the tea trees don't grow. You still have a lot of time on your hands. By tilling the soil, you will make the nutrients more available for the next spring. You will improve the soil structure so that it can hold more nutrients and water. But in a tea garden, you can't do that with a tractor. You have to do it by hand. It will take a lot of time. Do you have that time? Well, it depends. Maybe you have other crops you have to take care of in winter. Maybe you have a lot of tea gardens and you won't possibly till the soil everywhere. You could also bring manure to the fields. But where do you get the manure? Well, maybe if you raise cattle, you can have free manure. Then you'll need some time to spread it. In summer especially, pests can thrive in your tea gardens. How do you deal with them? Well, if you have a good biodiversity and natural predators in your tea garden, maybe you don't care about them, because by eating the leaves or spreading disease, the pest will most probably impair your yield. But maybe you don't care about it because you have a lot of tea gardens anyway and you wouldn't have time to pick it everywhere. So when trying to understand a farmer's decision, you have to list all the operations they do in the tea gardens, and for each operation try to estimate how much time it takes for them. You can deal with a specific problem with different operations. For example, for clearing the weeds, you can either clear it with machete, clear it with a trimmer, or clear it with herbicide. Well, obviously, clearing it with machete will take you most time. If you bought a trimmer, which is an investment, it will take you less time than a machete. But still, it will take much more time than clearing it with herbicide. In Jingmai Mountain, that problem is very real in summer. In Jingmai Mountain, people have a lot of tea gardens, so much that the farmers can't even manage them all by themselves. They have to rely a lot on migrant workers. Those workers are also farmers. They typically come from the valley where they grow rice, and those migrant workers have their own constraints too. They come to Jingmai when they are not busy with their own fields. Now, in summer, those migrant workers are busy with their own crops, And that's also at that time that you need to clear the weeds. So in Jingmai Mountain, for example, the farmers who have a lot of tea gardens, few people at home available, and who can't hire migrant workers at that time of the year, will have to use herbicide to clear their gardens. It will take them much less time. You have to clear the weeds in all of the tea gardens in any way if you want a decent yield. So they are left with no other options than clearing with herbicide. Now I hear a lot of tea buyers criticizing this move because they don't like herbicide being sprayed on the tea gardens. But you have to put yourself in the feet of the farmer. He has to clear that weed. And he has other constraints too. The local government has its own goals. For example, in Jingmai, in 2010, they decided to make the plantations in Jingmai more ecological, and they prohibited the use of chemical fertilizer and pesticides. Depending on the government's policy and its power in the region, of course they will try to enforce their regulations, and sometimes it can prove hard, maybe because they don't have the means to monitor the farmers and check what they're doing in the fields. Maybe they don't have enough agricultural technicians who will go there and check. Maybe the farmers' tea gardens are too remote to be controlled, and maybe the regulations imposed on the tea farmers are too stringent. They can't comply with the regulations because it would change too much their system. Well, in Jingmai Mountain in 2010, the switch to more ecologically friendly agricultural practices was heavily subsidized. For example, they reduced the plantation density, but the farmers didn't have to do the work themselves. The government hired workers from outside to cut 4 out of 5 tea trees and reduce the plantation density. In this case, most of the farmers complied with the prohibition of chemical fertilizer and insecticide because it could fit in their production system. They had a lot of tea gardens from the beginning, and the increased price of tea would compensate largely for their decreased yield. But the government is now struggling with the prohibition of herbicide. They want to phase it out in Jingmai, but because people have so many tea gardens and there's that recurrent lack of workforce in summer, well, it's pretty hard for some of the farmers to comply with this regulation. And of course, all the farmers don't react in the same way. Some farmers from the beginning totally complied with the government's requirements, while some others are less compliant. I hope in the future the farmers and the government can find a solution about this issue, because it would be great to have a herbicide free Jingmai. It's just a lack of workforce, but it's often the case in agriculture. The farmer's strategy also depends on the tools they have. For example, before the 2000s, very few people had a motorbike, and when you don't have a motorbike, it means you have to walk to a tea garden to pick it. After the 2000s, the widespread use of motorbikes allowed the farmers to cover more ground, and that means they could plant tea in more remote locations on Jingmai Mountain. The motorbikes partly allowed them to expand their tea gardens and increase the amount of hours they could work in the fields during a day. If you have to walk for 2 hours before reaching your tea garden, that's 2 hours less for picking tea or doing other tasks. The market price of tea also somewhat influences what's possible and what's not for a farmer. If the tea is sold for a high price, the farmer can invest a lot of time and a lot of money in a tea garden. They can also make enough money with a lower yield. But from an individual point of view, the higher the price of tea, the more they want to produce. So as the price of tea increases in a tea mountain, there's that individual incentive to increase your yield. And generally, where tea is expensive, the consumers like to have a low yield. And here we have a problem. The collective incentive of producing low yield, high quality tea sold for a high price in a highly famous terroir goes against the individual will of producing as much as possible to make more money. And that's where the government has to hold things tight. For example, in Yiwu Mountain, as the price of tea increased in some villages, according to the rumor, the farmers started spraying pesticides. And that rumor spread in the tea circles, and now the price of their tea is stagnating because of that bad reputation. Whether the rumor is true or not doesn't matter. What matters is the opinion of the tea buyers, who will decide to buy or not to buy tea from that village. And therefore, it's important for a village to keep a good reputation as a whole, So actually, when putting in place those kind of ecological measures, while the farmers want to work collectively in order to keep those environmental standards high, it would be beneficial for an individual in a highly famous village to increase his yield by spraying pesticides, but it would be highly detrimental to the community. And it's the government's job to make sure that the standard is respected. Now, as consumers, you have an impact on those agricultural practices, but this impact is very indirect. I would say that even the tea buyers who go to Jingmai buy tea don't have much control on the agricultural practices. Buying 100 kilo of tea won't convince a tea farmer to change his practices. Now, making a contract with a farmer, buying his whole production over several years, might give you more bargaining power, more control over his production. But even in the case of large tea factories buying tea in large quantities from farmers, it's been proven very hard to convince people to change their practices without government support, and especially if the area is very famous. In more remote areas, which have a hard time selling their tea, the buyer has more power. But in famous areas like Banzhong, Yiwu, Jingmai, if you don't buy the tea, someone else will. And that's where the government has its role to play. As a tea consumer, your power over this system is in what you buy. And it's very important to be a discerning consumer, to be aware of the farmer's situation, and to understand how those farmers made their decisions. Your impact is the most indirect one, but it's also the most powerful one, because in the end, you matter most. If you want more videos about tea, agriculture and processing, please subscribe to our channel, like our videos. Thank you for your support. Thank you for watching. See you again.